no one's super interested in exploring gay affirmative therapy outcomes. Women who had gone to gay affirmative therapists who were Christians experienced so much shame because they were told that this is your who and you have no way out. That's the coercive thing, and it is the hopeless and shaming approach in those first few sessions create safety and a remarkable reduction in shame experiences. So it's literally the opposite of what the opponents say happens in this therapy. It's such a crazy, crazy belief that we believe that this is the only, virtually the only psychological experience that can't be changed is sexual
Right.
attractions.
I'm sure you've heard that science says no one can change sexual orientation. Science says that even trying so-called conversion therapy will make people suicidal or crazy. But is that really true? What does the science really say? Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, an international interfaith coalition to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Today, we're excited to have Dr. Carolyn Pela of the Arizona Christian University in Glendale, Arizona. She is the assistant dean and also a professor in the Human Development and Family Studies Department. She, with a colleague, have written an important paper that details the problems with the so-called science in this area. Her paper also reports the results of a survey that they did, and their survey runs counter to the accepted narrative. I know you're going to love her. Dr. Carolyn Pela, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you, Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris. It's so nice to be here and talking about this. I'm pleased. I'm so pleased to have the opportunity.
Dr. Carolyn, we've been trying to get together for a while now. We've had a couple of misstarts and everything. But when I saw your paper, my colleague, Father Paul Sullins, told me about your paper. And when I saw your paper and read it, I realized how important it was. And so we're going to be talking about this paper with a co-author, Philip Sutton. The title of the paper is Sexual Fluidity and Well-being in Men, a Therapeutic Outcome Study. Tell us, what's the general subject of this paper?
Yeah, it's we're looking at folks who, and in this case, men who are dissatisfied or curious in relationship to their same-sex attractions. So they either, are disturbed by those, or they're just like maybe interested in exploring their what we call sexual attraction fluidity.
How did you get interested in this topic? You personally, Carolyn, how did you get interested in this subject?
Yeah, well, I'm a therapist in addition to a researcher, and this has been an area of specialization for me for many, many years. And I've also served in different capacities with organizations that seek to equip therapists for helping people who come to their offices wanting the opportunity to just explore their sexual attraction fluidity. For example, the Alliance for Therapeutic and Counseling Choice, and the International, we changed the name, International Foundation for Therapy and Counseling Choice. Both of those organizations I've been on the board. And so it's been part of what I've done. I started seeing people with this issue many years ago and decided to become more helpful for other therapists who want to help people.
And so your training is in, are you basically a clinical person? Are you, what?
I'm primarily a clinical and academic. I spent many, most of my career as an academician and a clinician both.
Okay, and so now you're the dean of something or other.
I'm
What are
the
you the dean
dean.
of
I'm
exactly?
in. Yeah, I'm actually a professor of marriage and family therapy and psychology, and the Dean of Graduate and Online Studies at Arizona Christian University.
Okay, so you've got a lot of training in this area, a lot of experience in this area, and in your experience, people have come to you to talk to you about their sexual orientation and whether it might be fluid in some way for them.
Mm-hmm.
That's your basic background.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and so let's start in this area with just clarifying some of the terminology, because it seems to me that a lot of the battle is fought with words and over words and the proper use of words. So you use a specific set of terminology to describe the type of therapeutic process that you use. Can you tell us how do you describe what you do?
Right. So I actually don't talk about any specific therapeutic process for
okay.
what I do. Except for mainstream psychotherapy, I tend to do, you know, the model I use is narrative therapy. What the battle is over is not therapy. There are already laws against, a harmful therapy. There are already guidelines in place. That's not the battle. The battle is against people setting their goals, being self-determined and autonomous and coming to therapy and being allowed to set their own treatment goals, to be pursuing the things they want. That's where the battle is. And that's what people don't understand. I do believe the opponents of this process of allowing people to explore their sexual attraction fluidity understand that. But I think a lot of the people who would be, really, that's what this is about? I mean, people aren't allowed to set their own therapeutic goals. That's exactly right. That's what this is about. So it's not about the type of therapy. That's something that has been this been communicated by the other side, that there's this mysterious thing that happens in therapy. No, it's cognitive behavioral therapy. It's narrative therapy. It's psychodynamic therapy. It's therapy. Good therapy is good therapy. The battle's against people setting their therapeutic goals.
And so what is the therapeutic goal that is being, that's at stake here? Spell it out for people.
Yes, to explore sexual attraction fluidity. That's it. And a lot of the time when people come in with that agenda, they have some other things alongside it that are related to it, correlates, factors that accompany same-sex attraction. And sometimes it's trauma, sometimes it's addiction issues, sometimes it's family of origin issues. And I'm a marriage and family therapy, so I'm always thinking about that piece of it. Other relationship issues, other interpersonal relationship issues, and all kinds of things. But they're coming because they're dissatisfied with not having opposite sex attraction to the level that they want, and maybe even dissatisfied, with the same sex attraction, kind of both.
And so the term conversion therapy is a term that is invented by the opponents of this particular set of therapeutic choices. What do you think the term conversion therapy is meant to imply to the public? How did that term become a loaded term? What do you think that, how do you think that works? How do you see that?
Yeah, it's this idea that somehow the therapist is coercive. That for instance, a young man, that's the typical client who approaches us for the opportunity to explore this. So a young man will come and we will shame him and coerce him and, do some terrible things that don't facilitate change in anybody. But that's what they think that it is. When people, I know I've talked to people and they're like appalled that I would possibly entertain somebody's desire to explore their sexual attraction because they believe that it's associated with coercion.
Right. And some of the spokespeople that they have for this tell these stories about that they were physically tortured and different kinds of aversion therapy and this kind of stuff. And I don't think those stories have been exactly corroborated or validated, right? And we know for a fact over here at the Ruth Institute, we took a pretty close look at Mr. Sam Brinton, who's kind of the poster child for all of this stuff. And we had, I don't know if you're aware of this set of interviews that I did with a person who, Susan Constantine is her name. She is an expert on deception. And she often testifies in court based on voice tremors and body language and different things like that. Is this person deceptive? And she analyzed, she and her team, she has a whole team of people who do this kind of thing. And she her testimony is accepted in courts of law. And they looked at Sam Brinton and said, this guy is highly deceptive. You know, in other words, they don't say, you're a liar. They basically say, the indicators are that this is deception. Around these words, this is deceptive, you know, that kind of thing.
Wow.
And, you know, and since we had those interviews, of course, this is the guy who was appointed to some position in the Biden administration and who was later found stealing women's luggage off of luggage carousel. So he's obviously got some honesty issues, but this has been the poster child for creating the association in the public's mind that conversion therapy is intrinsically coercive and, you know, harmful and that you're inflicting something on them. I think another aspect of it, Carolyn, if I may, is an attempt to directly or not so directly or indirectly to smear religion, you know, to basically say, because you are in some of the, I've seen even in some of the language of the bills and stuff, they're saying, the only reason somebody would want to change is because of this religious background.
Yeah.
Right. And so the religious background itself is coercive because there's nothing wrong with being gay, you know? And so if you're troubled, it's because somebody put that in your mind.
Right.
What do you have to say about that? I'd like to get your response to that.
Right. Right. Yeah, exactly. That it is anti-faith. And of course, many of the people in the study were people of faith. And those are the kinds of people who may really want to explore their sexual attraction because their values are not congruent with, you know, a gay lifestyle. And they would prefer to pursue a more traditional family experience. And so this is an opportunity to explore that possibility. It's interesting how essentially what's being said is that you should privilege your sexual feelings over your core values of faith. In other words, your real identity is about what your erotic attractions. That's your real identity, as opposed to your identity in Christ, as I identify myself as. That's my primary identity. And many religious people who are Christians would say the same thing. And of course, right. That's, you know, that should go a step down from my erotic attraction identity, which is crazy.
Well, tacitly, they are promoting their own version of a religious primary goal, right? In other words, they're elevating the sexual attraction above other kinds of values and asserting without proof, one has to say, asserting without proof that this is the best, you know, that it's obvious that this should be the way that a person lives.
Right, right. You know, and I don't remember which version of the APA guidelines, but if you read them carefully, there's literally in those guidelines says to therapists, if you encounter somebody who are part of a church that isn't gay affirmative, you should find a different church.
They're telling the therapist.
Yeah, in the guidelines. They're in the guidelines for practitioners.
So they're telling you how you should behave?
They're practice guidelines for working with people with LGB. Yeah, I think it was before the T. The LGB issues, some of the original practice guidelines produced by the APA, therefore they were specifically written to help people, practitioners, psychologists deal with people with same-sex attraction and That was the guidance for us, is to tell our clients to find a different church, a different religion, if their religion was not the same religion, their religion, the religion of LGBT, you know.
So they didn't tell you as a therapist that you needed a new church, but that it was your job to tell the client that they needed a new church.
Exactly. That's part of gay affirmative therapy.
Yes, yes. And that reminds me, see, this is one of the things that I thought was very striking and very helpful about your paper, because in the opening part, in the literature review, you know, before you get to your own survey, you talk about the literature. And one of the things you talk about is gay affirmative therapy. So tell people a little bit about gay affirmative therapy versus what do you want to call your therapy? You use the term, Father Sullins uses the term sexual orientation change efforts. Some people use the term change allowing therapy. Some people use sexual attraction, fluidity, exploration, and therapy, which is safety, abbreviated safety.
Yeah, I use safety.
Joe Nicolosi. Yeah. And Joe Nicolosi uses reintegrative therapy.
Therapy is under the umbrella of safety.
I see.
Reintegrative therapy is a set of protocols. It's an actual approach to therapy that he uses for people with addictions. He uses it for people with trauma of other kinds. It's not related to same-sex attraction necessarily. That's mm-hmm. Reintegrative therapy is an approach to therapy that facilitates change in a lot of areas of a person's life. He doesn't just use it with people who enter with same-sex attraction issues. So it's a model of therapy that he's created. So that's what I need people to hear. There is not a model of therapy that is exclusively, it's not like these people are so different that we have to create a separate model of therapy for them. We just use our own therapy approaches for,
yes.
And it's actually more of a, you know, for people who are more eclectic in their clinical practice, they kind of look at the personality of the person, not their sexual attractions. You know, they look at, you know, what kind of person is this and what kind of therapy techniques might work best with them. And it's not a one-stop shop for most of us. We have a little bit of eclecticism going on, but I call it safety, because safety is about the client autonomy. It emphasizes their opportunity to explore sexual attraction fluidity with the help of therapist. And, yes. And so it's not a model. It's not a model. Every single model of therapy could go underneath that umbrella of safety. Safety emphasizes client autonomy. So I don't like terms like sexual orientation change efforts. That's not what that's not what I do. That mm-hmm. that inspires the opposite, the proponents, the opponents or the proponents of these laws. It plays right into their hands. Like you said in the beginning, language is important in this. And mm-hmm. as long as we continue to go along with their language, I don't even believe in sexual orientation, actually. So I don't think there's no evidence in the literature that there is truly a sexual orientation, because sexual attraction is so fluid and it's mm-hmm. normal. Fluidity is normal. So the idea sexual orientation sounds like there is it enforces that idea of an identity.
Yes. Yes. And I've noticed that in my research too, that the people who study in this area, just the statistician people, if you ask them, what are the questions that you examine, there's kind of a list of different things, and people are not necessarily congruent in all of them. You know, who are you attracted to? What are your fantasies about? What actions have you done? And what did you do in the last 5 years? Versus what have you done since puberty? You know, it's not one thing. It's right. It's like this massive thing. So that's a really important point. And I make that point. We have a book, a report that we put together last year called the top five gay myths, you know, which we give out to people. And that's one of them. Sexual orientation isn't really a thing. We don't even know what it, you know, it isn't what you think it is, right? It's more complicated.
Right.
So, but the thing that is being protected here, this is all the controversy is designed to protect a certain view of sexual orientation, which is that it is a thing and that it's an immutable, inborn trait, sort of like race or being left-handed.
Right.
You know, that's what they want to promote. And so the opposite of that. So what you're suspect because you don't believe that, right? But what they're trying to say is that what the proper always the proper modality is gay affirming.
Right.
Gay affirming. That's right. What it has to be, because that's that. Otherwise, you're like trying to change a black person into a white person or a
right.
left-handed person into a right-handed person. You know, and so tell us about how gay affirmative therapy has been studied.
Right. And you know, it's interesting. There are some reviews of the gay affirmative therapy literature. There hasn't, it's not scrutinized nearly as much as safety has been.
Right.
And it's, but the folks who have produced reviews of that have admitted that, gosh, there's not a lot out there that shows us how, if it's effective, if it's not effective, if it's harmful, if it's not harmful. No one's super interested in exploring gay affirmative therapy outcomes, but there are some. And what we find is that it's based on, gay affirmative therapy is based on any, the theory is that anything that you come into therapy with distress over. If you are a sexual minority, you're non-heterosexual, then you are experiencing minority stress, and therefore that's why you have depression and anxiety. So what they try to do is, most of them try to address the symptoms, depression, anxiety, with mainstream psychotherapy. But then they add in this piece of gay affirmation that is supposed to lower any stigma experiences that the people have related to their sexual attractions. So interestingly, the research that I looked at when I did the paper, there's no change in that whole stigma thing there's no change in people's feelings about being sexually attracted to the same sex or whatever those, but they can change the depression and anxiety. So to me, that indicates there's not those two things aren't coupled. You can change one mm-hmm. and the other one stays, even though you're trying to fix the other one, it stays. That's what the research looks like. But again, there's not a lot of great research on it. So there are some design issues, but there are a few good studies out there. And the gay affirmation part is, when we really look at those issues, they don't budge the minority stress.
Yeah. So in other words, if a person comes into therapy with anxiety or depression or something like that, and they are a sexual minority, in effect, what a gay affirmative therapist is doing is treating the package deal. And you're not sure whether whether they're doing anything about the minority stress, but you can see, you might see, or you might not see, but you might see some change in the other symptoms like anxiety, depression, and that kind of
right,
stuff.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Right.
Right. If they are doing things to help the depression and the anxiety, some standard therapeutic modalities to do that, then those will be influenced much of the time, as much as anybody else would be experiencing that. But they also do all these gay affirmation interventions along with that, essentially. I don't really know exactly what that looks like, but it's the idea that they're trying to convince the person that this is your who. Your erotic attractions are your who, and unless you embrace that, unless you you acquiesce to this and give up whatever you thought your who was, you're not going to be healthy. You're going to be disturbed. So you have to go along with privileging your sexual attractions over anything else that you think is your who. That's gay affirmative therapy as I interpreted it.
And so is it fair to say that the standard that safety therapy is being held to is a very different standard than the standard that gay affirmative therapy is being held to?
Right. True safety. The therapist doesn't have a horse in the race. I don't want to insist on my approach is very, very supportive of the client's self-determination and their therapeutic goals are my agenda. I'm not going to try to convince them that they have to change their who, that they have to change their values in order to be healthy. I might think that about a client, but it's not my job. And the way I think about it is I'm not the Holy Spirit. That's not my job to convict people of, you know, how they treat their wives or whatever, you know, I mean, like whatever they're coming in with. My job is to help them reach their therapeutic goals, whatever those are.
So if a person was same-sex attract and came to you for depression and anxiety, and they were comfortable being same-sex attracted, that you wouldn't have anything to say about that particularly?
Yeah. I mean, those are a big chunk of my clients over the years. I got the word on the street, you know, word of mouth referrals from women who were in those circles. They had friends that were also same-sex attracted. And so they referred them to me when they were having relationship issues or just depression, anxiety, whatever, eating issues. And so I was working, I often worked with people who were completely fine with their same-sex attractions. They just came to me for other issues.
Would you counsel a same-sex couple?
I haven't had the opportunity to, since same-sex marriage became the law of the land, I haven't worked with couples with that issue. But I have in the past, when before it was marriage, I've worked with couples with their presenting issues. And, you know, women with same-sex attraction, the dynamics in their relationships, you know, varied from person to person, but oftentimes there was some codependency stuff and, you know, just helping them create boundaries and being healthy. But it wasn't about, it was way different than what I do with marriage therapy. Just like heterosexual couples who are cohabitating, I don't treat them the same as I do married couples.
Oh, that's interesting. That's very interesting. In what way? I'm just curious.
I don't, you know, again, their agenda is their agenda.
Right.
And I value their agenda. So if they have communication going on, but at the same time, the kind of attachment and bonding stuff that is helpful for a committed heterosexual relationship is not necessarily going to be helpful and not asked for by a cohabitating heterosexual couple or a same-sex couple. It's just different. The safety issues that they had, the intimacy issues, the vulnerability issues are going to be different. And just like premarital, when I was just talking to, I do a lot of supervision. And I was just talking about this with my supervision clients with premarital couples, you have to be careful when you're doing premarital therapy. You can't do the same thing you do with marital therapy because you're setting them up for a bonding that is not necessarily what they need to be doing. So that's me.
So in other words, if an unmarried couple comes to you for premarital counseling, you're not going to presume that they're going to get married.
Right.
You're not going to presume that their goals are going to be the same. And you see them and they interact with one another differently, presumably as well.
Yeah. Yeah, they do. I mean, marriage does change people and change their relationship. And different things come up then after they're married. So, because it is a different relationship. It's a unique relationship. A heterosexual marriage is a unique relationship beyond all other, and it's not, and I know that's a biblical perspective, but it's also born in the literature that they interact differently. There's different dynamics going on. There are different experiences as individuals when they're in those relationships. So it's, you know, all truth is God's truth. You know, what the Bible says is borne out in the literature. So if it's good research.
Right, right. Yeah, that's a really interesting way of putting it, because you see the same thing, you know, that, I mean, because I'm not a therapist, I'm, you know, more of a numbers social science kind of person. And you can easily see that, you know, it's not just that the Bible tells you that that marriage is different. The facts tell you that marriage is different.
Right.
You know, people do behave differently. It has a lot of different, you know, dynamics. Whether you believe in the sacramentality of the thing or not, there's something that you can see that's
right.
plainly different. But I want to get back to the standards in this debate over whether certain types of therapeutic goals should be hobbled or deprivileged, you know, which is really what is at stake here, is what you're telling me, because the people who are troubled by same-sex attraction are going to figure out something to do about that, but they're not, it's going to be harder for them. It's going to be harder for their therapists and their counselors and their priests and so on and so forth. But I'm interested in the state of the literature. I'd like to ask you this question, because you point this out. You just mentioned that we don't really know whether gay affirmation is helpful to people, because we don't have the data that allows us to answer that question. And yet, people, part of the argument for banning so-called conversion therapy is that it's not effective and it is harmful. What is the standard of proof that is demanded for safety or conversion therapy? What's the hurdle that they have to get over versus what is the hurdle that other kinds of therapeutic interventions are expected to meet?
Right. Well, the big hurdle, I think, for safety is funding research, because after all, we already know that it's harmful. So we can't fund research on it because we already know it's harmful, even though there's no research on it to show that it's harmful. You know, that's the craziness that they're saying. So, you know, research that is on safety, good research on safety is so limited, or at least the publication of it, because getting it published is really hard to do. But with gay affirmative therapy, yeah, let's do, you know, it's fine. Let's do that. Even though we have no proof whether it's harmful or not harmful. And of course, how would we? Because if there's no research on it, we wouldn't know. So it's okay to do research. You know, the more that there is skepticism over an issue, then maybe we really need to ask more questions, right? That skepticism should lead to questions, not to shutting down questions. But that's what happens with safety. We're not even allowed to do the research because, of course, we already know the outcomes, even though this research hasn't been done. It's craziness. It's just craziness.
Also, compared to just take conversion therapy and same-sex attraction, take all of that off the table and just ask, when somebody comes to you for treatment for depression or anxiety or obsessive compulsive disorder or something like that, what's a good success rate? What does success look like? What is an acceptable measure to say, oh, this is an okay modality because we have the evidence that some people are benefit? How many is some? What does it take for that to be acceptable?
Yeah. Well, in general, you know, when I was doing the review of people who are benefited by therapy, most people are benefited by therapy. I don't have the breakdown on each and every complaint or presenting problem, but generally speaking, most people are benefited by therapy. But as some research shows, as many as 46%, somewhere in there, don't really receive that much benefit it's not harmed. They're not harmed, but they're not necessarily benefited. It just depends on the study and how it's designed. But, you know, and what we know about depression, for example, in general, when we look at people who go to therapy for depression, we see categories of people. Some people, their depression is eradicated. Not very many who have had chronic depression have that experience, but some people do. Some people actually end up coping very well with depression. It still shows up sometimes in their lives, but they have strategies and they're doing some helpful things to keep it at bay. It's not intrusive. It's not taking over their lives. It's not keeping them from meeting their life goals. And then there are people who are just stuck in that place. So it's that way. All presenting problems, I would say, are on that same type of continuum. And we also know that different people respond differently to different modalities. There are certain personality characteristics that go into it. There are people who need to learn some other skills before the therapy even would even, some of these modalities would even work. But yes, we know that in general, therapy can be unhelpful and it can be harmful. So there's a difference between not being helpful and being harmful. Generally, harm is pretty low. Because we do have regulations. We in the U.S. we have some really good measures for public safety in relationship to psychotherapy. They're already in place. We don't need new laws on that. Although we need to, yes, continue to do research and continue to be open and asking what works best and what might be harmful to some people and maybe not others. But we have some really good boundaries in place and all kinds, you know, not only in the laws, but in different associations, codes of ethics and to protect people. That's in place.
The point is you wouldn't expect that.
Right.
So if people are looking at safety therapies or they're looking at what Dr. Nicolosi does or anything like that and saying, oh, only 30% were helped. And you go, okay, so what? You know, right. So what if only 30%, those 30% really appreciate it. And the others presumably, you know, tried something else to help them. And so all of the reason your paper is so helpful is that it helps people bring out the fact that this is not really about science. You know, I think that's the main thing that people need to see, that there's an ideological set of claims that are practically religious claims when it comes down to it, based on the things that you mentioned at the very beginning. Mm-hmm. And science is like a thin veneer over the top right. of what is essentially an ontological or theological kind of a claim. Yeah. So, this is a good time for us to take our break here. In a few minutes, we'll go over to the Locals channel. I want everybody to finish this conversation that I'm having with Dr. Carolyn Pela. I'm going to talk about her specific study and what she found. And I just want all of you to keep in mind, I've said this, if you follow the Dr. J Show, you've heard me say this before, but I'm going to say it again. And that is the radical sexual revolutionaries claim that sexual orientation is an inborn immutable trait that no one can change without harming themselves. And the fact is that claim is so extreme, even one counterexample is enough to refute it. And we got dozens of counterexamples. We got hundreds of counterexamples. It happens every day, okay? So we're going to go over to Locals. We're going to talk about the data. YouTube, try and shut us down. We're leaving. And we'll see you over there in just a minute.